The first thing you should do is try to find out if in your area there is a neuroendocrine tumor expert. Now, some of these experts are oncologists, others are endocrinologists, and others are gastroenterologists. But recognized neuroendocrine tumor experts are listed on, for example, the Carcinoid Cancer Foundation's website, and it would be advisable to see one once you get that diagnosis. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to transfer your care to a neuroendocrine tumor expert, because most of us like to work with your local doctor.
That's a good point.
So that's the most efficient way of starting, is to see the expert. Not specifically, and it's more common that that has something to do with the nerve roots coming out of the spine. Not always, but it's more common that it has to do with the nerves as opposed to vasoactive substances. Yeah, so when I hear people focus on recurring gastritis or ulcers, I try to remember that one can have carcinoids in various areas and can have other related tumors. And one of the things that can cause recurring gastritis symptoms or reflux symptoms is an elevated gastrin level, which can be caused by either drugs or tumors. So if I hear of a person who's having a hard time controlling those symptoms, I would draw a gastrin level. And also, again, see a neuroendocrine tumor specialist who's going to be aware of the fact that ulcers can be related to something other than serotonin. Yeah. So Dr. Warner and I have been particularly interested in the work of Dr. Oberg in Sweden, who is working on a viral approach to neuroendocrine tumors to see whether they can use viruses against the tumors to eliminate the disease. And every time we're together with Dr. Oberg, that's the first question we ask him, is how's the research coming along? And it is going forward. It is supported. It's too early to tell yet what kind of results they're going to have. But the research with viruses and viral-related particles called prions is very exciting research, not only for neuroendocrine tumors, but for other problems such as drug-resistant bacteria. We have some patients who have been sent to Europe, and now they're doing the same thing in Israel, to get a prion against staph infections that are completely drug resistant. Methicillin resistant staph aureus is a terrible killer. We have sent patients to Europe where they're doing the research, and they have taken that organism from the sick patient, developed a prion to fight it, given them prion therapy, and those patients come back within weeks completely cured of their bacterial infection. So we're hopeful that you'll one day be able to do the same for neuroendocrine tumors. And I'll just mention that we have a researcher at Mount Sinai who is doing work with the Drosophila, which is the fruit fly, and with anti-tumor approaches. And we said, well, you know, how can you study this disease in a fruit fly? And he said, well, you have to remember that a fruit fly has a complete intestinal tract. And that's the origin of neuroendocrine tumors. And so we're hopeful that ultimately he'll be able to do research with different types of approaches of therapy and try to get a hint as to something we should be trying in humans. So that's exciting as well. The answer is that we don't yet have evidence that sleep apnea contributes to causing neuroendocrine tumor progression. However, sleep apnea is a very important issue. And if there's a hint that a patient has sleep apnea, they should undergo a sleep study and get it taken care of, because that in and of itself increases the risk of mortality. And we believe, and that Richard Warner for many years has believed, that the approach to neuroendocrine tumors has to be a team approach. You cannot isolate a tumor without paying attention to the whole patient. And that would be an important issue to pay attention to. So that's another great question. The first thing, probably the most important thing, if you know you have a carcinoid syndrome or carcinoid tumor, is to have your doctor get you on to a somatostatin analog. And there are two that are commonly used in the United States. There are more than two around the world, but two that are commonly used in the United States. Sandostatin LAR was developed first, and that's a monthly injection. Sometimes it's given a little more frequently than monthly. And now we have a new one, somatuline, which is lanreotide, which is unlike the sandostatin LAR, which is a monthly intramuscular injection, usually in the buttock. The lanreotide, the somatuline injection, is a subcutaneous injection, and there are some advantages. One is that it's usually less painful, and the second is that it comes in pre-prepared syringes, whereas the sandostatin LAR must be mixed just prior to injecting it. And if it's not mixed just right, it coagulates, it congeals. And when they think they're giving an injection, you don't actually get your injection. So you could go for a month not realizing that you didn't get an effective injection. So lately we have been tending to recommend lanreotide, and often we are switching patients from sandostatin to somatuline. So the most sensitive scan for a neuroendocrine tumor is the gallium 68 PET CT. This is approximately 10 times as sensitive as the Octreo scan, which was the state-of-the-art scan until the gallium 68 scan was FDA approved within the last 2 years or so. So I would say that number one, I would begin by seeking out a neuroendocrine tumor specialist so that you will get the proper screening blood tests. And then if markers are elevated, the next step would probably be a gallium 68 PET CT scan. Or they may choose to do an MRI of your abdomen and chest, CT scan of the chest and an MRI of the abdomen. But I think it would be important, if the issue has been raised about symptoms suggesting possible carcinoid, to get yourself to a neuroendocrine tumor specialist, because it's going to be more efficient. Mm-hmm. The right tests are going to be drawn in terms of blood tests, and the proper scans will be done. And that would be the quickest way to get an answer. Just that one of the big problems that we're facing even today is that whereas patients diagnosed with carcinoid syndrome usually went for a mean of 9 years before they got their diagnosis, and they were symptomatic all that time, we've gotten it down to 4 to 5 years. There's no reason why, with proper education, we can't get that down much lower. by educating the population in general and doctors specifically to recognize that if there are symptoms such as diarrhea and flushing and recurring ulcers and things like that, that they should start thinking of things other than common gastritis, irritable bowel syndrome. In other words, once they've looked quickly to see what the cause is, if somebody is being given a medication and it's not resolving the symptoms, they should be persistent in looking for more unusual things. And Dr. Warner and others like to tell the analogy that when somebody has common symptoms and it's not responding, we should, of course, if we hear hoofbeats, think of horses. But if you hear hoofbeats, it could also be the rare thing, the zebra. And so you should start thinking of less common things if your symptoms are not quickly alleviated by the common therapy for the common diseases.
Thank you.